way right now. Is there a scheduled in time?
We should be back out that way.
Guys, don't go around. How you doing?
So wait, you got the
My grandbaby is
So wait, so I have a
Van Gundy, who gave him a great deal of good advice and support. They're also members of this committee, and Julianne Thompson for helping making this possible. Every member of the Gwinnett County Republican Party Board has played a major role in one form or another to make this happen, to make this successful. We have over 500 people that said they were going to make an attempt to come here. We probably have 450 or so, pretty significant number of people. Considering the weather and the conditions. And I'm greatly honored by the attendance today. I want to start by inviting Melvin Everson to come to the chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I do that, I want to invoke upon a privilege here to say that we are all Americans and we pray for all these candidates and their wives as they travel throughout the state of Georgia with their messages to all the voters. And we pray for their endurance, that they will not tire, that they will not fail, that they will prevail with their message. And with that, let us pray. Almighty and eternal Father, we humbly bow, the master and the creator of this universe that we call Earth, and part of this universe, Father, we thank you for this great state. We thank you for this great United States of America. We thank you, Father, for these candidates who have put their names on the ballot to be represented state of Georgia as the next governor. We pray for them, Father. We pray for their families. And when they're on the roads, exhausting themselves, difficult hours, we pray that you Be with them and comfort them. Be with their families as they are away from them many, many long hours. Allow them to be comforted knowing that you're with them every step of the way. Father, we pray for this nation. We pray for healing for this nation. We pray for President Trump and his administration. And Father, his cabinet members. We pray for those who are standing in harm's way to defend the liberties and freedoms that we so richly enjoy today, that have allowed us to assemble here as free Georgians and free Americans to listen to these candidates. And Father, we pray for those members who don the uniforms and for those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice that we can assemble here today. We pray for our law enforcement official, EMTs. They too are on the front line. And Father, we pray for this great flag of the United States of America. And Father, every time the national anthem is rendered, I shall stand. And Father, we thank you, we bless you, and we give you all praise, honor, and glory. While I respect what others believe and acknowledge what others believe, Father, I choose to end my prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to introduce today the moderators for today's event. First, B.J. Van Gundy, Assistant Secretary for the Gwinnett Republican Party and a former chairman of the Gwinnett County Party. Jason Thompson, who's 7th District Chairman of the Gwinnett Republican Party. And Rachel Little, who's 4th District Chairman of the Republican Party. At this time, I want to introduce and to acknowledge the color guard today, Boy Scouts from Troop 434 from Dunwoody, Nevin Aresh, Hudson Griffin, and Troop 525 from Peachtree Corners, Cardin Van Gundy. Thank you.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Father, retreat.
Leading the pledge was Roger Marmol, who is a longtime Republican and a city councilman in Seigle. I want to introduce the candidates today in the order of the program. First candidate is Casey Cagle, who is the Senate governor. Thank you. Hunter Hill, who's a former Georgia State. Brian Kemp, who's the current Secretary of State of Georgia. Clay Tippins, who's a Georgia business man. Michael Williams, who's a Georgia State Senator. And Marc, who's the author and former school teacher.
Thompson, Rachel Little are joining me today. I'd like to first explain the rules to the gentlemen and to all y'all. Please, first of all, set your cell phones to stun or off, please. That's that little vibrate thingy. Next, for the best use of the limited time we have with these six gentlemen, please refrain from applause and or other reactions after questions so that we can continue on with the next question. Each candidate will be allowed 2 minutes for opening remarks. That might be a surprise to some of them because it was originally set three, so let's see how they do on their feet shortening their speeches. They will each be given 90 seconds to answer each question. At my discretion, a 30-second rebuttal will be allotted if appropriate in the case that one reverts to another or otherwise. Closing remarks are going to be 1 minute each. We will change the order of the candidates as they answer questions so everybody gets a fair shot at being the first one to answer a question so the others are the ones saying me too. And no brass knuckles or nuclear warheads used between the candidates, please. Opening remarks, we'll start with Secretary of State Brian Kemp. Mr. Kemp.
Good evening. Thank you all for being here, and great appreciate the party putting us on. Great people, great folks turning out. My name is Brian Kemp. I'm a small business owner, have been for over 30 years now. My wife, Marnie, is here tonight with two of our daughters. We have three, and she tells people all the time, you know, running for governor was never in the marriage vows. But I was a frustrated small business owner, tired of government regulations, government taxes, and quite honestly, big government policies. And I got so frustrated, I decided to do something about it. Many of you that I've seen many times know that I'm from Athens, a county that voted for Michael Dukakis for president. So it's kind of a tough environment down there, but I've been a fighter my whole career, and I told people what I was going to do when I ran for the legislature, and I did it. After being back home for 3 years, focusing on my family and my businesses, I had the opportunity now to serve as Georgia's 27th Secretary of State. And I told people exactly what I was going to do when I was running, and I've done that, standing up to the Obama administration, suing them twice, and winning to protect our citizenship check and preserve our photo ID law. That's the exact same fight I'll take as governor, fighting to put you all Georgians first ahead of the special interest, the status quo, the politically correct, and those that are here illegally. Looking forward to the forum tonight. Thank you for having us. God bless.
Next, we'll hear from Mr. Michael Williams.
Thank you. And my name is Michael Williams, running to be the next governor of Georgia. And I am like most of all of you. I am a husband to an amazing, beautiful wife, and father to four children who are here today supporting me, and I appreciate that. I'm a small business owner, a CPA by trade. I used to own 18 sports clubs, haircuts locations, pretty much ESPN and Mr. Barbershop. I had 160 employees and Obamacare. Kind of put an end to that. I got frustrated with government regulations. I got tired of listening to candidates come up on stage, tell us all the things we want to hear, only to be elected to do something different. I was the first elected official here in Georgia to come out and endorse Donald Trump for president, because I knew that he was not bought and sold by lobbyists and special interests. Tonight, you're going to hear candidates talk about how they're going to fight the establishment, how they're going to fight the lobbyists and special interests, how it's weak politicians that are going to be the destruction of our company, of our country. Yet every single one of them up here, they get their funding from the same people that they say they're going to fight. How can you rationalize that? How can you wrap your arm around that? That's the reason why every single year when we elect people, we expect something different, but we don't get change because the same people are funding their campaigns. The people that are funding my campaign, they're the biscuit maker at Bojangles. It's the truck driver. It's the guy that's stocking shelves at Walmart. It's the people of Georgia that recognize that we are out there fighting for the world. I put my own money, I put my college, my children's college tuition on the line because I care about Georgia. I want real change in this state, not just political pandering by politicians. I'm Michael Williams, and I appreciate your support. Next, we'll hear from Hunter Hill.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming tonight and spending your Saturday night with us. I'm Hunter Hill. I'm a lifelong Georgian. And I grew up here my whole life. Got a chance to go to West Point to play football, so I jumped at that chance. And I picked to be an infantry officer upon graduating from West Point, which brought me down to beautiful Fort Benning, Georgia. And I became an airborne ranger and then led five different teams on three combat tours in Iraq and Afghanistan. I've been in the real estate business. I'm married to my beautiful wife, Shannon, who's down here in the front. And we have two wonderful children who are in our local public school in Cobb County, Teasley. I've been running a coaching company for the last 5 years. We help entrepreneurs and executives reach their full potential with our coaching. And I've been in the state senate for 5 years, and I can tell each and every one of you that there is so much more that we can be doing to move the conservative agenda forward in our great state and help us reach our full potential. But it's not going to happen unless we elect a true conservative leader to be our next governor. Because the values that you and I believe in, less government, less taxes, and more freedom, are not going to happen if we elect a career politician. So we're going to answer some questions tonight, and I look forward to sharing with you what my vision is. But I want to tell you how I make decisions, because a lot of decisions get brought before a governor, and I want you to know how I come to them. And I filter these decisions through really two fundamental principles. Number one, I'm a Christian. I gave my life to the Lord in the eighth grade, and the scriptures of the Old and New Testament inform who I am as a person, and it's how Shannon and I raise our kids. I'm not suggesting to you I'm perfect, but that's very foundational to the character and my leadership. Number two, the foundational principles of our country, the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States. And when you flow those two things together, some natural values flow out of that. That's why I'm 100% pro-life, 100% pro-Second Amendment, and a strong defender of religious liberty. So I look forward to answering your question, but those are my values, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Next up, we'll hear from Lieutenant Governor Casey Cagle.
Well, thank you all very much. Very much appreciate you giving up Saturday night to be with each of us. I think many of you hopefully have gotten to know me over the years. I'm a seventh generation Hall Countyan, married my sweetheart, high school sweetheart, and we have three wonderful boys. Two of them are grown, and three precious grandbabies now. And I've had the great privilege of really serving with two governors, and I've seen the governorship up close and personal. I know what it's like to negotiate through difficult public policy issues, but also economic development deals. We have seen a state that is now the number one state to do business in. That doesn't just happen by accident. It takes leadership. It takes someone with a forward vision of casting what we can become as a state. And fortunately, I also know how to not just write a budget, but to balance a budget and protect our AAA bond rating that we have as a state. But I also know how to draft the biggest tax cut in Georgia's history, which is a $5.7 billion cut that we ushered through the legislature this year. But I believe that it is about being a proven, consistent, conservative leader. And that is what you have in me. And I think all of you have watched my record. And when it comes to sanctuary cities, I'm not one that just talked about it. I'm one that led on it. What I did is I was focused on making sure that we not only outlawed, but we defunded. And I had the courage to go after a city that sadly enough was looking the other way. Making sure that Georgia citizens are protected, where officers do not have to violate their oath of office because of some liberal organization that's putting pressure on them, or the safety of our citizens. This race is about the future. It's about the vision. I want to take us to an entire new level, 500,000 new jobs in the first 4 years, making sure that we're building a world-class workforce that is second to none through the College and Career Academy Network, along with other workforce initiatives that I have. It's a pleasure to be with you tonight.
Next, we'll hear from Mr. Marc Urbach.
Well, good evening, and thank you for being here. It's great to be back in school. As I taught here at Norcross High School for 6 years, American history, world history, and civics. The love from students has brought me back. I have the best of memories from students, parents, my fellow teachers, and other citizens that have brought me back to this great journey. My dream is the same dream as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream, the same dream as our founding mothers and our founding fathers and God. And you might ask, what is that dream? That dream, I believe, is for all of God's children, all of us, to live together in love, in peace, in happiness. For my daughter, and for all students and all citizens of this great state of Georgia, to live together in love and peace and happiness, and not be controlled by this Satan-created New World Order, but for all of us to live together in liberty, freedom, as God intended. As a statesman candidate, the past 8 months, I will always uphold my oath to God, 10 million Georgians, and our future children, our posterity, and two constitutions, the Georgia Constitution, and in my personal opinion, one of the greatest documents in the history of the world, the United States Constitution, as I'm much more than a conservative or a fake conservative. I'm a constitutional expert. You have a choice for your next governor. You can choose career politicians and fake conservatives, or a statesman, a leader, a former school teacher, businessman, a professional author of 2 books, Believe. Do We Need a Third Great Awakening? That's been read by members of Congress and 400 Americans. It's one of the best books they've ever read. I love all of you and I believe in you. That's why I'm running for governor. And I know that together we will succeed. Team Urbach, we have the best plans for you and your family to grow jobs and take control of our schools. So God bless you, and thank you for being here. I look forward to answering all your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Urbach. We'll now go to Mr. Tippins, Mr. Clay Tippins.
Remember back to Genesis. Joseph was called before Pharaoh to not just interpret his dream, but talk about the future. He said there'll be 7 years and 20. Followed by 7 years of family, all you do things different than constantly. I think that's where our state is. There's 49 states right now that will kill each other. The question is, if we're going to have a great 21st century, do we keep doing the same things? If you look at all of our national debt, sometime in the next 5 or 10 years, we're going to be forced to reinvent government, do it better and cheaper. If you look at the nature of how we work, how we learn, how we live, all that's changed. Last 10 years more than the previous 100, and that rate of change is going to speed up. So at a time of change and a time of future like that, the question is, do you want someone that's been in politics in their career and steeped in those ways? Do you want someone with a different level of urgency and unconventional problem solving? I've never run for office before. I grew up here in Gwinnett County. I won a swimming scholarship to Stanford University. I got out, I served as a Navy SEAL, I served twice, once in my 20s, once in my 40s, and between then, I built and ran a large, successful technology business. My swim coach, who wasn't that far from here, he said there's 3 types of people. There's folks that say, I'm going to try. I'm going to do my best. There's people that do whatever it takes. That's been the history of my life. I learned that here, and I'll do whatever it takes to future-proof the state, create 21st century state. That's things, if you go through the ABCs, annihilating sex trafficking, MS-13 drug rings, things I'm uniquely qualified to do as a SEAL. Build some things, like a bypass around the land. Speed up the rate of what your dreadness is going for. Clean up the culture under the dome. Get rid of corporate cronyism, turn around for your politics. Drop the budget by $3 billion, drop taxes below 4%, ensuring that every child in Georgia can read. I'll do whatever it takes to accomplish this goal. And you should be the first.
Before we start with the candidate questioning, I did want to announce, because I had forgot to just a moment ago, but at the end of the forum, there will be a 10-minute media Q&A with the candidates. The person to follow for that, she just sat down, we'll make her stand back up, is Julianne Thompson. She'll lead you to the Q&A afterwards, so the media will go with her afterwards. All right. We'll now move into questions. Because Mr. Kemp started with the first answer, I'm going to go to the next person in line to have him be the first one to answer. The first question is for Michael Williams. It's from Jason Thompson.
Senator Williams, Governor Deal has led Georgia in implementing criminal justice reform. And let's face it, if he were a Democrat, the liberal media would be asking he'd get a Nobel Prize at this point, right? Will you continue to lead in this area if elected governor, and how?
Yes, Nathan Deal has done a great job on criminal justice reform. One of the things that I've learned here while serving in state senate is that in Georgia we have some of the highest individuals per capita that are on probation. The reason for that is because they can't afford to pay their ticket. So I believe that there's additional room for us to help with criminal justice reform. Also, Nathan Deal has done a pretty good job of making Georgia the number one state in the country to do business, as we heard, if you are a big corporation. One of the things that has made Georgia the best state in the country to do business is the tax credits that we give to all the corporations, the big corporations that come into our state. And not only will I help to make an equal level playing field for those in criminal justice reform, but also we need to create an even playing field for small businesses, for all those out there that want to create their own business here in Georgia. So yes, that's important.
Mr. Hill.
Thank you for the question. In my brief time in the Senate, I was very
supportive of those efforts to help the governor get through those criminal justice reforms. My vision for Georgia is about resources. And the fact is, if we cannot continue to spend money the way that we're spending it. In the brief time I've been in the Senate, the budget has grown from $17 billion just to $25 billion, and I was not in the General Assembly this year. We need to have a more limited and focused government that delivers results for taxpayers. I've seen us waste billions of dollars on low return activities, but a core competency of government is our criminal justice system. So I want to prioritize three areas of the budget in terms of budget reform, because these are the core competencies of government. I want to make sure that we're funding at the appropriate level, public safety, transportation, and education. Career politicians have been underfunding transportation for the last 40 years, and then their solution is to give you a tax increase. We need to fund transportation from the budget, from the money that we already have from the taxpayers. On criminal justice reform, I will continue to push forth those efforts to really distinguish the difference between the people that we're mad at and the people we're scared of. If we're scared of them, we need to lock them up and throw away the key. And if we're mad at them, we need to give them opportunities to get out and reach their full potential. But ministries and nonprofits are going to be the ones that help lift them up, not big government programs. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Casey Cagle.
Well, it's been an honor to partner with Governor Gill on the criminal justice reform package. And I thank you for those that have followed. Clearly, when it comes to individuals, just locking them up and taking away and throwing away the key is not fundamentally sound for some of our population. Those individuals and working with our local judicial system to provide drug courts and other types of efforts to try to make them become good citizens again, that are productive citizens going forward. I will tell you that there's criminal justice reform is not necessarily perfect. There are areas where individuals are showing back up in the jail, and it's basically been a slap on the wrist. And we've got to treat those crimes very seriously, and we will work with our sheriffs to do just that. But in terms of the criminal justice reform, I think Georgia has led the nation in that effort, and I applaud Governor Deal for it, and there is far more to be done. But when it comes to public safety, we have to do all that we can to ensure that we're supporting our local law enforcement officers that are out there. Too many of them are still on food stamps, and we've got to make sure that we crack down on those cities that are not willing to abide by the law as it pertains to sanctuary cities as well.
Thanks, sir. Marc Urbach, next, please.
Thank you, and it's a very good question and a very important question. And I'm not trying to make a joke, but have you guys gotten a good deal with Governor Nathan Deal in terms of criminal justice reform? This is common sense, and I am a very common sense man, okay, because it makes sense, as Thomas Paine wrote that book. Ask yourself this question. Basically, from 1955 to 1985, a 30-year span here in Georgia and across this great Republic of America, our crime rates were quite low. Okay, there's a reason why we have all this nonsense today, tremendous amounts of crime, and all the other nonsense. So as your governor, I am a leader, and that's what your representatives are supposed to be, leaders. And as a Christian here, as I wear the cross, my Savior is Jesus Christ, I will lead this great state and impugn in every citizen's heart and mind that all crimes come from the heart and mind. And whether a person wants to get rebaptized by a man or woman of Christ, because my Bible plan right here is believe in the Word of God, or hear the Word of God, believe in the Word of God, repent for your sins, accept that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, and get baptized or rebaptized by a man or woman of Christ. It's very optional, because we have great citizens in this great state of Georgia of other religions. But we know all hearts, all crimes come from the heart and mind. So I expect citizens to do the same. Tell your fellow neighbors, let's work together as great Georgians, because we are Georgians, we are Georgia, we will continue to make this great state the best state in the nation, and we will end putting criminals in the jails for criminal justice reform. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Urbach. Next up, Mr. Clay Tippins.
I would pick up at the time from Governor Hill to carry forward criminal justice reform, but let's talk about preventing crime and how to stop crime. Roughly a third of the folks that go to prisons end up back in prison within 3 years. And the best way to predict how many prison deaths we're going to be paying for in 10 to 15 years is third grade reading. And on third grade reading, roughly two-thirds of our third graders in this state do not read at a third grade level. That's why I talk about that so much, is that's the way to keep people out of prison. Now let's talk about how we stop network crime. You live in a state with 10 million citizens where we prescribed 541 million opium pills in the past 12 months. And that directly contributes to our heroin. You're sitting right now in Metro Atlanta, the number one place in the United States of America for sex trafficking. Sex trafficking is one of the most pure, raw forms of evil on the planet. And those gangs that do that completely overlap with your MS-13, your heroin networks, your legal gun networks. The thing, though, is on the sex trafficking, that one is addressable because it's on the internet. The very techniques and methods that I and my colleagues employ the SEALs overseas identify, target, and take down networks and terrorists are absolutely the things that we can do, should do, and must do, and I will do, to take down sex trafficking networks. And when we do that, that will also put a hurt on heroin networks, gun networks, and MS-13. And again, that's something you need to qualify to do.
Thank you, Clay. Next up, Brian Kemp.
Well, thank you. I agree with much of what everyone said about the job that Governor Deal's done. I'm certainly supportive of his efforts and others. I'm a strong supporter of the accountability course. And it's also moving the needle. But for someone that is the only person running for governor that actually has been in charge of the law enforcement division, we have 20 post-certified investigators in the Secretary of State's office, mostly working on financial investigations, financial fraud investigations, obviously elections investigations, and professional licensing issues. But the question for me is, where do we go next? And we just released a detailed plan to track and deport illegal criminal aliens from our state.
creating a criminal illegal alien database that will allow and give tools to law enforcement and policymakers to do a better job of tracking these folks, talking to state law enforcement officials and the prosecutors. This is something that has been a challenge for them, not knowing who these people are. They commit a crime, get bailed out, go home, come back under another identity. This database will help us be able to work with the feds, with our state leaders, with our partners at the local level, give law enforcement the tools they need, because these people are killing our children, either with drugs or with guns or with deadly assaults. And it's time that we put a stop to that. So that is where I believe we go next.
Thank you, sir. Now that we've heard from all of them on that question, I will turn to Rachel Little for the next question. Rachel.
Thank you, BJ. Good evening, gentlemen. So let's talk a little bit about transportation. Traffic continues to be a hot topic here in Gwinnett and really around the state. And ever since the failure of T-Splice, Georgians have continued to wait for the illustrious and elusive Plan B. There are several plans that are making their way through the legislature this session, including Senate Bill 386, which will create a regional transportation oversight board for Metro Atlanta. The Georgia DOT has also recently announced a plan to build a $1.8 billion truck-only highway from Macon to Atlanta. What are your thoughts about these plans and others that are sort of working their way through? And what is your vision to get us all where we want to go as quickly and as safely as possible?
We're going to start this round with Hunter Hill.
Well, thank you for the question. It's so important. You know, transportation is a core competency of government. When you think of the things that private citizens can't be expected to deliver, we are focused on our own private property. But the government has always promised and made investments in connecting private property. It's an economic development issue too. Business and enterprise is demanding that we be able to connect one another to goods and services. Bottom line is we've underinvested in transportation for the last 40 years as a government. In the 1970s, when Atlanta was robustly growing, transportation was 15% of the budget. It's now dwindled down to 5%. And then career politicians said, well, we've got to fund transportation. So career politicians like Casey Cagle championed a huge tax increase to fund transportation at a higher rate. I think we need to do the hard work of cutting areas in the budget to prioritize that which is a core competency. There's wonderful ideas that have been left on the books, that some of which you mentioned, but we need to do the truck transit route. We're spending all this money in the port. We need to expand I-16 west to tie it into Grange or Columbus, and then do the northern route that circumnavigates Atlanta so that truck traffic not destined for Atlanta does not have to go through Atlanta. We have 18-wheelers on the roads, that each 18-wheeler accounts for 11 commuter cars. And so we've got to get the commercial traffic in and out of Atlanta quicker, and we've got to make investments. Thank you.
Thank you, Hunter. Now we'll go to Casey Cagle, please, sir.
First and foremost, we spend more for right-of-way acquisition than we do for road construction today in our state. We have to utilize our assets in the most efficient way, which means that we have to think outside the box. For most of you, like I am, I'm in Marl County, I go to Atlanta every morning. In that time period, there is an enormous amount of congestion that exists. But when I look across the median, I see that there is a lot of capacity there. In any other state that has this type of congestion, we would be using the reversible lane concept that allows movable barriers to access more capacity on the AM time lane and then switch it in the PM time. This is the creative thought that we have to have that is in the Department of Transportation, working hand in hand, looking at elevated road systems that do the same thing that utilizes the existing assets that we have, along with making sure that we're willing to go around or go under if that is required, all in a 10-year strategic plan that puts the priority around funding where it is needed most. But also we have to be committed to making sure that we're partnering, and we are. And this is why this bill is very important.
is because the federal government is stepping in to give those that want to help themselves like us. So this rapid transit dedicated road system that we can build is going to be critically important to a tool and toolbox that will solve a lot of our challenges.
Thank you, Casey. Next up, to answer the same question, is Mr. Urbach. Marc?
Well, thank you, and it's a very, very important question. As your governor, on day one, fighting for you and your families in the Georgia Constitution, we the people of Georgia, I will file and open up my own investigation into what the media called the I-85 bridge collapse. Because the veterans that I know have told me, and I know, and we know exactly what happened, and it wasn't what the media told you. Okay, but let's get back to transportation. It's very important. Here in Georgia, a great state, we're going to get about 2.5 million people over the next 10 years. About 500,000 are going to move to Metro inside the perimeter. This is the brochure I've been handing out for about 7 months. Okay, and transportation is very important for all of us. If you think the traffic's bad now, what is the traffic going to be like in 5 years, 10 years? So I have a, I think, very, very common sense for the future of our children and their children. And I say this, if the French can do it and the Japanese can do it with a high-speed bullet train, can good old Georgians do it? Because we can. But working with career politicians and fake conservatives for so long, they haven't funded transportation properly. So as your governor, we can do a high-speed bullet train from Atlanta, connecting the fall line cities of Columbus, making Augusta back to Atlanta. Or we can, as I told, this is not a joke, I was joking around when I said it to the Art Commission, I'm going to get rid of Marmol and replace it with Murdo, moving everyone rapidly through Atlanta and Georgia. And the chairman loved it. Okay? 2 weeks later, I said, forget about Murdo, let's go with Murdo Go. Moving everyone rapidly through Atlanta and Georgia. We can extend it up to North Carolina and down to Florida. So transportation,
time
to build it. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you, Mr. Urbach. Mr. Tippins.
We're the only major southern city without an outer bypass. The only one. We could do an outer bypass. We could have trucking companies, logistics companies pay every time they ride down that road. They'd be happy to do that because they'd make more money not wasting time seeing the downtown connector for traffic. That's number one. Number two. Our Savannah Port is one of the best assets that this state has. We've got to get ahead and stay ahead of Charleston, Jacksonville, Norfolk. It's got a 7-1 ROI, and we're 2.5 years behind schedule. With the balance sheet the governor gave us left us, I think we're in a position of looking at accelerating that using more towards the money. Other cities around the country have synchronized their traffic lights using data, doing basic stuff, and increased throughput by 20%. So those are some of the things that I think are part of 21st century infrastructure in Georgia. Now, here's what we shouldn't do. We shouldn't increase taxes to pay for it. We should spend more, but not increase taxes to pay for it. Next, we can't ask folks in South Georgia to pay for our things up here. People should enjoy what they pay for. We should pay for it by removing waste, fraud, and abuse, and efficiencies out of our government. We've cut as much as $3 billion when we had to because of recession, but we haven't done that while times were good. We've got almost 20 to 25% of the state workforce retiring in the next 3 or 4 years of baby boomers. We're still on the verge of a once-in-a-generation opportunity to transform and strengthen our government, create $3 billion to invest in roads, education, and the access to workforce. That's the way we need to go.
Thank you, Clay. And Brian Kemp.
Well, great question, great ideas. Question is, nobody's really saying how much is it going to cost and who's going to pay for it. So I'll be a governor that will do that, number one. Look for the best return on investment, which I've been saying for months is driving from, you know, four lane and Macon over to LaGrange, Highway 27 up toward Northwest Georgia, Chattanooga, to really get truck traffic that's coming out of the ports off I-75 north. If it doesn't have to come through the metro area, shoot those trucks and trailers around Atlanta. The same for I-75 south that's coming up. Also, continue to expand and build the inland ports up in Murray County where you can have containers that are coming off of the roads onto rail before they ever get to Atlanta, expand the Cordell port. You know, I think all of those things will be good logistically for our state and economically. Also support regional ideas. In this county, Gwinnett has done a tremendous amount for somebody that drives 316 every now and then. It's refreshing to see the road work that's been done and the overpasses. We need to continue to support their efforts in doing that or other regional efforts that may be going on. But we also need to think about innovation. You know, there was an article in the paper today about autonomous trucks, self-driving trucks. We need to prepare for that. If we have dedicated lanes for rapid bus transit, we can do the same for autonomous or self-driving vehicles.
Thank you, Brian. And last for this question will be Michael Williams.
Like Brian said, there have all been a lot of really good ideas. Nobody's talked about funding. Even Brian didn't mention where the funding was going to come from. I am the only candidate up here that is a CPA. I've actually been able to dive into our budget and figure out there's billions of dollars every single year that we waste. We can take that money and put it in transportation so that we can fund the roads that we so desperately need. Also, I don't know about you guys, but I'm tired of lying politicians and politicians that take credit for stuff they don't do. You heard Casey Cagle talk about the biggest tax decrease in Georgia history. He's not responsible for that. You know who is responsible for that? Donald Trump. He passed the biggest tax decrease in our generation, and in passing that tax decrease, the state of Georgia was going to be the longest windfall. So we had to pass the tax decrease, or else the state of Georgia would take your tax money. You know what else? He wouldn't even support Donald Trump. Not even when it was Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton. He didn't want to go against the money people, the lobbyists and special interests. So he's taking credit for something he didn't do. On top of that, I'm glad to hear he's finally acknowledging that law enforcement officers are on welfare. I've been talking about how 3,200 of our law enforcement officers are currently on welfare for over a year now. I've got two bills in the Senate to remedy that. He will not let them have a hearing. Instead of solving the problem, he issued a commission to talk about it. I want to solve that problem.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Williams. I would like to give Mr. Cagle 30 seconds to respond.
I don't know that it's really worth my time really answering what the senator has articulated, because more often than not, every part of his comments are not baked or true. The reality is, anybody can go and look and see that I did vote for Donald Trump. That is ludicrous to insinuate that I would not. And to insinuate that we did not pass a net $1 billion tax cut to the citizens of Georgia is also ridiculous.
Thank you, Casey. All right, we're done with that question. First up on this next question will be Casey Cagle. And I turn to Jason Thompson to take the next question.
Lieutenant Governor, as Attorney General Jeff Sessions is propping up civil asset forfeiture programs as a key tool to allow law enforcement officers to effectively fight the war on drugs, civil asset forfeiture reform is sweeping the nation as due process and property rights are under attack. What will you do as governor to address this?
Well, I mean, I think for those that have followed my career know that I've always been a staunch defender as it pertains to property rights. And oftentimes these issues become very complex when you are dealing with trying to ensure safety, but also protecting the individual and their rights that exist within real property. And we will balance that out. I will tell you that the Attorney General, I think, is doing an extremely good job, particularly in what he is doing for California and going after them to really break this cycle of the sanctuary city component. But let's be honest, for the important parts of our state, and for each citizen, it really starts with building a workforce that is second to none. A lot of our problems for relative to crime get solved when individuals have good paying jobs. That is why I've been so committed to the College and Career Academy network that I've created, 46 of those across the state, where we've demonstrated that we can not only have graduation rates at 95%, but we can increase their earning potential to $30,000 a year minimum. Imagine when we begin creating that kind of value added for every citizen, a lot of our criminal crime problems will go away. And that's where my priority and my focus is going to be, giving kids more opportunities to climb the economic ladder.
All right, thank you, Casey. Next to answer that same question is Marc Urbach.
Thank you. It's a very good question. As your governor, as a statesman, you're not just getting a statesman for your next governor. I'm going to be like a sheriff, and I will use the power of my office to call the sheriffs and tell them to get right with the law, as they're supposed to enforce all laws, including due process rights of people that their officers put in the police car and take to the jail. Due process rights everyone is afforded, especially when people break the law. No more throwing people in jail for days, hours and days, because that's breaking due process law, okay? So again, as your governor, I will enforce all laws and make sure that everyone here in Georgia that's wearing a badge, most of them are good. I talk to sheriffs and police officers all the time. God bless the men and women of blue, because they're under attack. I've talked to citizens, thousands of citizens in the last 8 months, and they tell me their husbands, their officers, do not have the right material, the body armor, and they're not even allowed to purchase their own body armor. That's because we're working with, dealing with career politicians and fake conservatives. As your governor, all men and women of blue will have the necessary equipment, and we will enforce the laws of this state for them, their families, and the people that break the laws. Thank you so much.
All right, next up is Clay Tippins on civil asset forfeiture. Yes.
Private property rights are similar things in this country built on. Law enforcement should not be able to continue holding private property after someone's been found innocent and moved on, and unfortunately that happens. Let's talk about another funding-related issue in law enforcement. There are illegal immigrants that are arrested and they're released because of the cost the county pays, and sometimes they do it for lack of funding, they release them back. That's not right either. What we need to do, though, to put our law enforcement in the position they need to keep our community safe and themselves safe, is tackle these network crime issues. And network crime is hard in Georgia because we've got 159 counties. It's hard to coordinate these things across a lot of different local municipalities. That's why sex trafficking, the heroin rings, they persist. And the people who have proven over and over again that they're very, very good at doing that around the world are people from my background, Navy SEALs. There's a fusion center methodology that you can use to basically collect the best intelligence in real time, put that together, get a picture of a network, and drive and coordinate activities across all the different agencies and groups that have to be coordinated in order to identify, target, and take down those networks of people. Again, I'm not an expert on everything, but it's something I'm an expert on, I will bring you the governorship.
Thank you, Mr. Tippins. Brian Kemp.
Well, certainly a strong supporter of the due process. I have a record of that as Secretary of State with our law enforcement division and as chair in the State Elections Board. For anybody that has ever been to one of those meetings, you know the process that we go through, not only from the intense investigation that we do, also recommending the action to the State Election Board, and then the State Election Board goes through a hearing process where we hear both sides and make a decision. And I certainly think that is the rule of law in Georgia, and it certainly would be under a Kemp administration. I, too, have a very strong record when I was in the legislature on private property rights. But I think, again, it goes to, from a law enforcement perspective, where do we go from here? It seems like sometimes in our state and in our country, we give those here illegally, especially criminals, more due process than we do our own people. And that is one reason that I had put the plan out to create a criminal illegal alien database. And we will track and deport and work with anyone to be able to do that. Where you, the taxpayer, is not paying to house these people in our prisons unless they have killed or murdered someone, and we will not let them back in to our country. Hopefully, when Donald Trump gets finished building the wall and passing comprehensive illegal immigration reform. So that is what my objectives will be as your governor.
Thank you, Brian. And last for this question, Michael Williams.
Well, I absolutely believe in property rights. In fact, for almost 10 years, I had to fight my own government to protect my own property, my rights, and my liberties. I had to spend over $100,000 in doing so, and I would fight tooth and nail for all of Georgians' property rights. Also, I don't know about y'all, but I took it as an insult when Casey said it wasn't worth his time to respond. I know y'all came here to hear from us, and for him to have the contempt towards you guys is an insult. Also, Casey, we can't look to see how you voted, unless Brian Kemp knows. Is that Casey Cagle campaigned heavily for Jeb Bush, the career politician. He was silent when it came to going out there and campaigning for Donald Trump. Also, there is no budget decrease. There is no real tax decrease. Nathan Deal, he put out his budget before there is even contemplation of a tax decrease. That budget that he put out has not changed. Even after we pass this law that gives us the tax breaks that Donald Trump put into place, there is no additional tax decrease because the budget hasn't changed.
All right, thank you. I need to ask the candidates to please stick to the answers to the questions. And Casey, if you'd like 30 seconds again.
Let me be very, very clear in case anyone is questioning. This is not meant to be disrespectful in any way, but I want to be very clear. I'm not running against any person for governor. I'm not running for a job, and I'm not running for a title because I don't need one. I'm running to make a difference. This is a big vision for the state, and that's what I'm going to talk about, not the little games that I don't want to play.
Thank you. Next up, go ahead, I wasn't trying to skip you.
Yeah, no problem. Civil asset forfeiture is wrong. You don't take people's personal property unless they are actually convicted of the crime. The larger issue is this. We have this situation, basically, where our local law enforcement are not funded appropriately. So they're clamoring for ways to get goods and services to fund their operation, which is dead wrong. We shouldn't put them in that operation. That's why I want to have a more limited and focused government that delivers results for taxpayers. We've got to prioritize public safety in the budget process, and then transportation and education. These are the core competencies of government. That means we got to bring all things on the table. We've got to do Medicaid reform. We've got to do welfare reform. Look, our communities are breaking down because there's an expectation that the government do ever more and ever more and ever more for us as people. It's made ministries and nonprofits be less relevant in our communities. That our founders really believed in a more limited government so that we could work together to deal with the social ills that face us. But we need to prioritize funding to our law enforcement so they don't need to figure out creative ways to take from people who are not convicted criminals. It's wrong. And we need to do the hard work as limited government conservatives to cut wasteful spending and put our state on the right track for the future. Thank you.
Next, we'll go to Rachel Little for the next question. And first up to answer the question will be Marc Urbach.
Mr. Urbach, let's talk a little bit about jobs. Governor Deal has been a national leader in bringing jobs and industry to Georgia during his 2 terms in office. Under his leadership, Georgia has become the number one place to make movies and TV shows, particularly right here in Gwinnett County. Last week, Facebook announced that they are building a data center in Covington, and of course, we all know that Atlanta is on the short list for Amazon HQ2. If elected, how will you continue to ensure that Georgia remains the number one state in the country to do business and to grow our economy?
Well, thank you, Rachel. It's a very good question. And as your governor, we, the people of Georgia, will decide, the people, not the government. I don't believe, as your governor, it's the governor's responsibility or the state legislature's responsibility to pick winners or losers. Fair competition, limited government. But as your governor, my second duty, right next to the safety and security of all citizens, is to grow this state in terms of jobs. Okay, that's very important. So we will continue to make Georgia the best state in the nation to live, work, and play. And together, we will continue to make Georgia better with the movie-making business, because I was interviewed by the Oz magazine for 2.5 hours, and they loved my ideas for documentaries and movies here all over Georgia, okay? But we need to do what's right. I don't believe, as your governor, it's proper for us to give $11 billion to Jeff Bezos so he can build his brick and mortar, okay? That's called picking winners or losers. But we have, we will create jobs. I have a 3-point plan to build jobs, okay? Because I think in threes, like the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, okay? So I want to build trade schools all over Georgia. Trade schools, brick and mortars. Right next to that, healthcare facility, brick and mortars. Some people take better care of their cars and their bodies. And right next to that, a brick and mortar high-tech facility. Three brick and mortars right next to each other. Think of all the jobs that will be created, okay? So God bless Jeff Bezos, because my book is being sold by Amazon in CreateSpace, but we will do what's right to create jobs and make Georgia the best state in the nation to live, work, and play. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you, Mr. Urbach. And Clay Tippins next, please, thank you.
Earlier, I ran a large technology business, and so I've actually sat at those tables and been in those rooms when those sorts of decisions got made, counseling CEOs on how they should approach those decisions, where's the best place for companies to relocate businesses and to build businesses. So one of the best, most important things to be able to sell is if you sat there and been part of the buying decision. So I don't think anyone on the stage is more qualified than I am to sell Georgia, to sell our workforce, to sell the great assets that our state has. Let's talk about how those assets can be better and Georgia can be better. First of all, we don't have a great environment, legally speaking, for doing business. We should expand business force in the state. We're in the bottom third of the country on that. Number two, even though we're the number one place for doing business, we need to have our income taxes below 4%. That will continue, allow us to continue to be ahead of places like Florida and Texas when it comes to those things. The other thing is we need a great workforce. And again, there's so many things that we have to do to have a 21st century workforce. And I keep going back to it, but if the cornerstone of the house is broken, the house falls down. We need to have an education system where first and foremost our children can read, and then that will lead to a more competitive workforce over the next 50 years.
Thank you, Clay. Next up, Mr. Kemp.
Well, I said this the other night, buy Marc Urbach's book and vote for me. As a small business owner for over 30 years now, I know the next step for us in Georgia is to make Georgia number one for small business, building off the great things that we've done. I've been doing that for 30 years in construction. We have a stone business. I've been involved in manufacturing. I know how the rubber meets the road with working Georgians and small business people. We need to cut government regulations. That is part of my conservative 4-point plan. We need to fundamentally reform how government spends, taxes, and operates by implementing a spending cap so we can continue to do tax reform in our state that helps working Georgians, small business owners, and Georgia families, and quit giving tax breaks to special interest groups. We've got to have strong workforce development in our state from an educational perspective, and we need to go not only to foreign countries on trade missions, but we need to go to states like California and Maryland, who are literally over-regulating, over-taxing their businesses, and tell them, come to Georgia. We've got a business environment. We've got plenty of land. We've got great people. That, to me, is how we continue to make Georgia the best state in the country, not only for business, but for small business.
Thank you, Brian. Next up, Michael Williams.
As I mentioned before, Georgia has been called the best state in the country to do business for 5 years in a row because we give large corporations big tax breaks to come here. I've traveled the state and talked to hundreds of small business owners that tell me story after story about how they're trying to get their small business going, but they can't because of the red tape and the regulations. We need to eliminate CON regulations. We need to destroy the lobbying group that protects the three-tier system for alcohol. We need to eliminate our state income tax so that we can create an environment here in Georgia where small businesses thrive. That's what's going to make Georgia great for everyone, not these large corporations that are getting these tax breaks. Also, let me be clear, Casey. You have been lieutenant governor in the state of Georgia for 12 years. 10 of those years, the state was controlled by Republicans, both in the House, the Senate, and the governor's office. Where is the conservative legislation that we so desperately need? Why does Georgia not have a ban on abortions after the heartbeat of the fetus is coming? There's a bill right now in the Senate. You can allow it to pass, but I doubt you will.
All right. Apparently, we'd like to hear from Casey for an answer. So, Casey, how about it?
Well, listen, there's a lot of people that would want to tear our state down. But let me just be very clear as well. We are the capital of the South. Nobody compares to who we are and what we are doing in the state. You don't see people leaving Georgia to go to California. You don't see them, was that my 30th?
You can answer whatever you want right now. Yeah, it was a 30-second answer. It was a 30-second. And you have another 20 now still. So.
I thought I was answering the question.
I understand. No. You can answer Mr. Williams.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll cancel that.
All right. All right. So back to me then. All right. And I will now turn to, Hunter, did I do you again? I did it. Now, and then I got to go to Casey. I'm getting this. This is going to Casey like twice every round. So, go ahead, Hunter.
Thank you. Well, career politicians will tell you that they create jobs. But the bottom line is, I think we all know this, hardworking Georgians create jobs. Innovative Georgians create jobs. And in fact, I want to get Amazon, and it'd be great if they came. But I don't want to give away the farm for it. These are your public dollars that politicians are bringing on the table to try to bring them here. What I want to do is create a fair and predictable market for businesses to compete. And I believe capital and investment and job growth will naturally ensue here in Georgia outside of the purview of the government. The governor and the Economic Development Department doesn't need to keep going out and buying business to come here if we have an incredibly competitive marketplace here in Georgia. So, what are they looking for? Really, it's three things. What's your tax and regulatory environment like? That's why I want to eliminate the Georgia state income tax. They're looking at what's your transportation network like? How do you move goods and services to market? That's why I want to double our investment in transportation in my first term without raising taxes. And then finally, they're looking at, do you have a workforce that's ready, willing, and able to take on the jobs that investment is bringing here? And we're doing great on technical college and career academies, and our higher education is outstanding. Where we have fallen behind is in K-12, and that's why I want to elevate K-12 education by empowering families with the resources we're already spending on K-12 education. It's the economic principle of competition, the free market principle of competition, and I believe that will elevate all boats in K-12, and then we will be, people will just be moving here without us going out and buying them to come here.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. And Casey, now.
That's a good question. Well, very good.
All right.
Well, first of all, I am probably the only person that's been at the negotiating table as we have added 700,000 jobs since 2011. And my goal is to add 500,000 jobs. And these are private sector jobs, and I know what makes those jobs become a reality. It is not government, it is the private sector. And making sure that we are a low tax state, a low regulatory environment, along with a tort system and a workforce that is second to none, is the building blocks. Let me tell you though, our tax credit system that is in place is a statutory tax credit. If you think that you're gonna recruit companies without any kind of incentive that are statutory at all, you are flat wrong. It is the most competitive environment out there. And we have done a good job, but it's all managed based on a return on investment. Now let me just say, when we're talking about this state,
When you look at the fact that logistically where we are, with the fastest growing port, the busiest airport, the Fortune 500 companies that we have, along with the research institutions that are second to none, you can penetrate 80% of the marketplace within a 2-hour flight time, along with rail and truck as well. These are the things that have allowed us to be where we are, and it's taken leaders that have been willing to step up and do the right thing, because people need jobs. People can talk all they want, but it's time for folks to be walking the walk instead of just talking the talk.
Thank you, Casey. Now, I will start a new round, and the first to answer this question will be Clay Tippins. Now, in the interest of time, and just to make this interesting, we're going to go to a 60-second speed round of answers. Not really that speedy, but really, ooh, yeah. So, we're going to go to 60-second answers, and Jason.
Before I forget, a quick shout-out to Marc Williams with Printing Trade Company for making these and donating these programs. Thank you, Marc Williams. Mr. Tippins, Georgia leaders continue to tout the fact that our state has been named the number one state to do business. We hear this numerous times. Yet the one area that we seem to not be extending innovation and free market competition is in the state's healthcare system. As you know, many of our state are 2 hours away from the nearest emergency room. Do you have a plan to reform Georgia's certificate of need regulations? And if so, give us a brief description.
See, 60 seconds is plenty of time to get to it.
All right, healthcare needs to go down by 15% to cost. There's several different pieces. First of all, we've got the dumbest, most expensive form of healthcare in many cases, which is someone goes to an emergency room where an aspirin costs $4. We've got to treat people more proactively, closer to where they work, where they learn, where they live. Part of that is mobile technology. Part of that is consuming the unused capacity in our system. Your typical ambulance company, for example, is about half unused. That is a mobile ER on wheels that could be stepping in and checking on the people who are at risk for things like type 2 diabetes, checking on them, checking blood sugar. 1% of us drive 40% of all the costs to go to healthcare. 5% of us drive 50%. We've got to figure out a way to have a healthcare system in the 21st century. It's more technology enabled, more proactive, and treats people closer to where they work.
Thank you, Clay. And Brian Kemp.
Difficult issue, but I think for areas, especially in rural health care, we've got to have innovation. We need to make sure we have high-speed internet in all areas of our state where we can do innovative things like telemedicine and other things that will move the needle. But look, the best way to fix that problem is with investment, with better economic opportunities and good-paying jobs in those areas. If our rural communities continue to shrink in population, no matter how much Medicaid money the Democrats want to throw at them, that model never works. That is simple economics. So we've got to focus on all areas of our state to make sure that people have that same innovation and opportunity. But we also need to say no to the special interest at the Capitol and free up the private sector to help lower Medicaid costs. I'm a firm believer that that can happen, and you can move the needle in that way as well.
Thank you, Brian. I believe.
I don't think it's that difficult of a solution. What we need to do is eliminate CON. Basically, that the CON models we have in place require businesses to get the permission from the government, from the state government, before they can open up a medical facility. We have to eliminate that. I'm not just the man that gets up here and talks. I actually have a bill in the Senate right now to do just that. Also, what we need to do is unleash the nurses that are currently in our state. We have regulations that tie their hands and prevent them from utilizing their full scope of practice. I also have a bill in the Senate to do that. Neither one of those have been heard by Casey. Also, the 700,000 jobs that Casey said have brought to the state of Georgia, those jobs have brought the average earnings for Georgians down from the 27th in the nation all the way down to the 41st in the nation. So those jobs aren't really high-paying jobs. They're just tax credits going to these big corporations so they can get campaign contributions. Look at Jason's disclosures. from the biggest corporations that come into the state, Mercedes, Caterpillar, and Gulfstream. They've given him tens of thousands of dollars.
Thank you, Michael. And next, Hunter Hill.
I think we all know that the career politicians created the crisis that we're feeling in healthcare. Number one, we need to get our folks to, and Congress, to work with President Trump and finally repeal Obamacare. It's the most unconstitutional law in the history of our country. And it's also, it's hurting our families, especially hurting the elderly. But the bottom line is we need more free market principles and we need more personal responsibility in healthcare. If we don't put it in there, then we're never going to get this thing solved. That's why in my brief time in the Senate, I got through direct primary care, which is a free market principle. It increases the doctor-patient relationship and makes it a transaction directly between the two of them. I got it through the Senate. It's not gotten through the House yet. I've also put forth bills to reform CON, and of course, I couldn't get that through the Senate because of the man who runs the Senate doesn't agree with me on that. But the bottom line is this. We've got to have free market principles and personal responsibility if we're ever going to fix health care.
Thank you, Hunter. And now Casey Cagle, please.
Welcome to the Casey Cagle Show. First of all, when it comes to health care, Hunter's actually right. The biggest thing that would help the state is if Congress would actually act and repeal Obamacare. It is way too costly, and sadly enough, it is not meeting individuals' needs. And it is creating to individuals in terms of their allotted household income that is at a percentage that is absolutely not acceptable. But as a state, we can take action, and I did, on the Innovation Council, along with the Innovation Health Center, making sure that we're bringing a type of delivery system to our state that meets the needs of our citizens, but also providing insurance that meets the needs of the citizens at a price by which they can afford. That is what we need, and we need the free market to work. We don't need a one-size-fits-all. What works in California is not necessarily what's going to work in Georgia, and we've got the tools to get us there.
All right, and finally, Mr. Urbach.
Well, thank you, and it's a very good question. Mr. Governor, on day one, I will repeal Obamacare. Why? Because it violates the United States Constitution, the Fifth Amendment. It also violates Georgia's theft by taking statute 16-8-2. We, the people of Georgia, the Constitution right here, are the first branch of the five branches of government. The fourth branch I've studied with Justice Antonin Scalia. That's the grand jury, and I'm trying to use it right now with my attorney. But back to health care. We, the people of Georgia, okay, are removing Washington, D.C. from our health care here in Georgia. Okay, so what are we going to do about health care in Georgia? Well, we have a lot of care competition, and we're going to build, like I said, the healthcare centers next to the trade skills, next to the high-tech facilities, and we need to remove Washington, D.C. from Georgia so we can take care of our healthcare. We'll be a lot better off, and I think you all agree about that, because we Georgians control our state, and D.C. doesn't control us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Marc. And we'll have one last question here before we go into closing statements. And once again, we'll do 60 seconds. And I turn to Rachel, and Brian, you'll be the first one to answer this one.
Sorry, Secretary Kemp. I'm gonna go a little bit farther away from Gwinnett County, but still very important to Georgians. Talk a little bit about offshore drilling. Recently, the Trump administration and Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke announced their intention to open up 90% of U.S. offshore territory to oil and gas exploration, which would include our beautiful Georgia coast. Do you support this move? And what will you do to help or stop the administration?
Well, what I've learned over the course of the campaign is there's serious concerns from the Department of Defense, some of our military bases about drilling, what the negative impacts of that can be. And I've also been told, and I'm not positive this is 100% true, but I've also been told that it really doesn't matter what we think, if those concerns are out there, that it probably won't happen anyway. So I would reserve judgment to obviously what Governor Deal is working on through federal partners. And I will say this, too. There is certainly a lot of concern in certain areas of our state and our coastal communities about the potential impact on tourism. But that being said, I'm also a supporter of having a diverse energy supply. It's great what America's been doing and being able to supply themselves with the resources and energy we need.
Thank you, Mr. Kemp. And Michael Williams.
I absolutely support the President and his executive order to allow offshore drilling. This is something that Republicans have wanted ever since Ronald Reagan. We have it now. I don't understand why Republicans are running from this. We have an opportunity to become an energy exporter, the energy leader of the world. We need to take advantage of that. Georgia needs to be a big part of that. In eliminating the state income tax, we can help fund that gap there with the energy oil that we sell. So I think it's very possible for us to drill offshore while protecting our beaches. I don't think it's an either or. We can have both. And I absolutely support the President and his measure and believe that Georgia needs to take a leadership stance on drilling offshore and becoming energy.
Thank you.
I think it's a good thing that we now have the ability to look at this, but I also think that we ought to take into account what's going on along our coastline. And if it can be proven that it can be done cleanly, then we ought to push for it, notwithstanding the defense challenges. And we do have a nuclear submarine base in Georgia, which it's amazing how strategic our state is from a military standpoint. And we do have that base, and I can see why they wouldn't want it to happen. And I would defer to the military over drilling in this case. But just one more thing since I've got a few minutes here. Career politicians use phrases that I want people to be aware of, things like creating jobs, making deals for economic development, and leveraging federal dollars. All those statements, I think we need to be very cautious about, because those federal dollars that we're leveraging are your dollars. And so we need to be very cautious about how we're using the taxpayers' dollars to leverage them for some benefit for Georgia, because those are your dollars. And we need to be fiscally responsible. We need to have a more limited and focused government that delivers results for taxpayers. Thank you.
Well, obviously, first of all, I think it is important, as Martin alluded to, that you can't have your eyes open when you go into any type of drill. Part of that certainly is the base itself, the marine base, and what that could, and the impact that could have, not just simply on it, but also jobs and our relationship with the federal government. But on the same token, we need to be willing to look at ways in which we can become more energy independent, and I do support that, but not in a vacuum. And I do appreciate the President's stance by which he has taken it. But we also have the other component, and that is that we have a beautiful, beautiful coastline, and it is very ecologically sensitive, and we have to be mindful of that as well. So there has to be the balance that exists, and we can't just simply say, drill regardless.
Well, thank you. It's very, very interesting how, imagine Georgia becoming energy independent. Imagine all the jobs created in the next 15 years, because it's going to take about that long before they even put the first oil drills platforms in the ocean. I was the only candidate that I know of down about 3 weeks ago at the Renaissance Airport Hotel with representatives from the BOEM, the Bureau of Ocean Energy and Management. I didn't see anybody else there, but I'm working 20-hour days for you and your families. And I saw everything, all the photos were on Facebook, and I learned a lot. With all things in life, there's good and bad. The amount of jobs and technology and becoming energy independent is quite remarkable for Georgians. But we have to protect the coastline and make sure everything that's built, whether the oil platforms or the wind farms, will be safe. So as your governor, I will sit down with the experts. Right now, I like the plan, but if the experts prove that it's not good for Georgians, we'll do what's best for Georgia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Urbach. And Clay Tippins.
I like keeping things kind of simple and direct. We're pretty much seeing different flavors of the same thing, which is we're glad that we've got offshore drilling in the country. That's good. We want to expand access to energy at a cheaper price. That's good. But we've got at least three assets on our Georgia coast we've got to watch out for and not drill right offshore. One is your base. Second is the beautiful city of Savannah. And third is those amazing beach environments we have on the coast. We've got to figure out a way to have expanded energy access without hurting any of our Georgia assets, including this region.
Thank you, Mr. Tippins. And we will move into closing remarks now. But before we do so, I want to thank the best timekeeper ever, Victoria Witham. And y'all would have seen my son be with the Boy Scouts at the beginning of this, my oldest son, but my youngest son, who's only 11, is still awake in the front row. What I'd like to do now is go into closing remarks, and we'll do those in reverse order of the opening remarks. So, Mr. Tippins, I go to you, Clay.
Thanks, appreciate it. Thanks for coming tonight. Look, I've never looked at my ballot and thought to myself, you know what's missing here? Is more political experience. We need more of that. That's not what I usually think when I look at my ballot. So, if that is what you want, then good news, your cup runneth over. 40 or 50 years of the ground that had been taken. I've got a different background. I successfully run a large business. I serve my country in the field. I bring a different level of urgency, an unconditional whatever it takes problem-solving approach. At a moment in time where we're going to figure out how to run government better and cheaper, our society changing faster than it ever has before, I think that different background is actually the right model for this moment in time, and that's why I jumped in the race. I hope some of you support that on May 22nd. Thank you.
Marc.
Well, thank you so much for being here. It's an honor to be back to Norcross High School where I taught for 6 years. It's an honor of my life to be speaking in front of Georgians because we are the best citizens in the nation. Georgia is the best state in the nation. And this is for many people, this is a difficult choice in the times we live in. But the thousands of people that I've spoken to on my team and citizens the past 8 months, we know what is in the General Assembly now. Conservatives, career politicians, and you have a choice to put in a statesman, a leader, a former teacher, a former small businessman, Austin, Texas, a professional author, a journalist, and a citizen that will fight for justice and enforce the law for you and your families as I continue to try to use the grand jury for you and your families. Matt Bevin gives me inspiration. He's currently the governor of Kentucky. He had no political experience. All he was a former businessman associated with some party called the Tea Party. I have a lot more acumen and skills than that man. And may God bless you and your families. May God bless the great state of Georgia. And may God bless the great Republic of the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you, Marc. And Casey Cagle.
Well, thank you all very, very much for being here and being so wonderful tonight as well. Georgia's a great place, and we are very, very blessed to be honored to be public servants. All public servants are not crooks. All public servants are not career politicians. They're people, oftentimes, who have a heart, who care about others. And I will tell you from my personal point of view, I didn't choose to get into public life. I've been in business for 32 years. I feel it's a calling to be where I'm at. And I will tell you, this state, when you look at what we have accomplished as being the number one state to do business in, you look at what we've done in terms of adding 30% increase in GDP, along with 400 times the venture capital presence within our state, all using a proven, consistent, conservative message. That's the future, and that's the kind of leader we're about to do.
Thank you,
Lieutenant
Governor. Andre Hill.
Great to be with you. Thank you for spending your Saturday night with us. Y'all are looking really at two things. How are you going to choose who to pick up here? And for me, it's the fact that I have a truly conservative governing philosophy and a leadership experience to get the values and principles that we all believe in, less government, less taxes, and more freedom, implemented into policy.
That's what we've been campaigning on for the last 4 years, and I'm tired of Republicans campaigning like Ronald Reagan and then governing like Barack Obama. So I have a truly conservative governing philosophy. I'll talk about that in the beginning, but I also have the diverse leadership experience to get those ideas implemented into policy. I'm the only candidate on this field that has led in business. I've led in combat on three tours, and I've fought for the values and principles that we believe in the state Senate. So I'm uniquely prepared to tackle the tough issues that face our state, move people towards a common goal, and deliver results for you, the taxpayer, and I'd be grateful to earn your support on May 22nd, and please visit votehunterbill.com. We'd love to have you on our team. Thank you.
Shown you guys what I am about. I am tired, sick and tired of politicians that come up here, tell us all the things we want to hear. They do a great job of it. When they get elected, though, they do something else. We've seen it happen time and time again. Go look at each and every one of these candidates' disclosures, where they are getting their money from. That is who they are going to be beholden to. When it comes time to decide, am I going to be true to a political campaign promise, or am I going to do something my donor wants me to do? They're going to choose the donor. I am the only candidate up here that is putting my own money in this race and relying upon the hard-working Georgians to fund my campaign so that I can be beholden to you, the people of Georgia.
Yes, Secretary St. Brinkin.
Well, thank you all for having us tonight. As I mentioned earlier, I've been a small businessman for over 30 years. Instead of doing debate prep this afternoon, I was looking over our corporate tax returns. I'm a candidate in this race that has detailed plans to create a criminal, illegal, alien database, to have good educational opportunities, to strengthen rural Georgia, to make Georgia number one for small business, to fundamentally reform how state government spends, operates, and taxes. But the question is, who do you really trust that's saying things up here tonight? And I would urge you to look at my record, to look at what I said when I ran for Secretary of State, that I would fight and win for you to have secure elections, and I would use technology to make the Secretary of State's office more efficient, to run better with less money and less people. We have done that. I will do that as your governor. You can see all of these plans on our website, kempforgovernor.com. And if you will trust me, I promise I will do as I've told you. I will put Georgians first to have the special interest and status quo politically correct and those that are here illegally. Thank you so much.
Questioning portion of the forum, I'd like to just make some quick announcements and say some thanks. First of all, on Monday night, there is a Greater Gwinnett Republican Women's Secretary of State Forum at the Gwinnett County Republican Party headquarters at Gwinnett Place Mall. That's Monday night. More information on the web. If you Google it, you'll find it. I'll put a link on my Facebook if y'all want to do it. Please visit the concessions outside on your way out, grab a cookie. Maybe you can work out a special deal if you grab a bunch of cookies. There is, just to remind the media, there is a 10-minute media meet and greet after this. Follow Julianne once again, and she will take you to that. None of y'all go anywhere. Also go to Julianne. I want to thank, once again, Norcross High School for this great facility and accommodation. Four 34 and 525 are Boy Scouts. The Gwinnett County Republican Party for putting this on. And I'd especially like to thank my fellow moderators and the candidates themselves for coming tonight and spending their time with y'all who had nothing better to do on a Saturday night. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you. except for a trash can, so.
I think this is a little bit informal, so I didn't know.
Are we supposed to go in there?
No, they can be out here.
I want to talk to the mayor.
Yeah. We're doing it right here?
Roughly one out of five children in Georgia.
We're going in the back.
Roughly one out of 50 schools provide any sort of support for that. So that's something we need to work
everybody.
On.
Everybody, please, back here.
Let me get playing first.
Go ahead. I think that'd be a nice touch.
God gave us a heart, mind, and mouth. The same.
God bless her. I'm with you, man.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is how this is going to work. This is going to be very short because the candidates want to get out and talk to the voters. So I am going to probably, I'm going to see how the time goes. I don't know if we'll have time for every person from the press to answer or to ask a question, but we're going to try to get in at least 3 to 5 questions. So make them broad, if you will. I'm going to start with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
Is
Casey not going to join us?
He opted out, I believe.
Okay.
Yes.
A lot of talk out there about Amazon and what the state should or shouldn't do to get them here. Just if you'd like to talk a little bit more about that and where you stand.
Who are you addressing?
How do you want to stand?
Yeah.
Let's start with Hunter Hill.
Okay.
I'd love it if Amazon came, but I think Georgia should be on the short list. I want Georgia to be on the short list for every company in this country, and we do that by having a fair and predictable environment for business. That's why I want to eliminate the income tax in our state. That's why I want to double our investment in transportation in my first term without raising taxes. And then also we need to elevate K-12 in our state. I think if we do those things, then businesses will be clamoring to move to Georgia, and Amazon would, I'd be glad if they'd be one of them.
Well, I agree. I think it'd be a game changer to get Amazon, but I also think if we don't get them, we got so many great things going on in our state that we'll continue on, like recent announcements we've had, quite honestly. But for me, the next step and what I'll focus on as governor is making Georgia number one for small business, which I talked about that a lot tonight, so I won't go into great detail on that, but that really starts with a spending cap that's tied to population and inflation. So we're budgeting conservatively in the good times like we're in now, and we have the resources to properly fund the things that we need to do in state government, like education, transportation, health care, and public safety.
I too would love for Amazon to come, but I've been one of the most vocal against giving away tax credits, especially the amounts that are being offered right now. We know that New Jersey is offered $7 billion. I've read reports that Amazon is wanting anywhere from $9 to $11 billion. That's going to be about $200,000 per job, a 100-year payback. That is not a good investment for Georgians. Plus, when all these 50,000 people come to Georgia, who's going to pay for the roads they drive on? Who's going to pay for the schools their kids go to? It's not going to be the employees from Amazon or Amazon, because they're getting all these tax breaks. It's going to fall on the backs of the Georgians that are already here. We have to create a state in which all business thrives. It's also why I was against the Delta tax exemption. We don't need to pick winners and losers. We need to make sure we have an environment, again, where small business and all Georgians can thrive.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we all want Amazon. Companies make decisions based on a few factors. One is regulatory environment. We need a low regulatory environment. The second is the tax load. We need to shrink our state budget by $2-3 billion, get income taxes below 4%. But, you know, ultimately, if you're an Amazon, they're going to get to a point where all the cities are putting forward similar economic proposals. As a business person, I've been at those sorts of tables of negotiations. The way that we can win those sorts of battles with the other cities and other states is selling the other pieces, selling our college university system. We should be talking about making all parts of Georgia the sandbox that companies come not just to bring their jobs, but to build their next industries. In the case of Amazon, that's things like emphasizing autonomous driving, drone delivery. We've got assets in metro Atlanta like Fort McPherson that can be a great sandbox where the companies of tomorrow can come and not just bring jobs, but make this the place to build their innovation, to build the industries of tomorrow. And as someone that's been a successful technology business person, I feel uniquely qualified to lead in that effort.
All right, well, thank you so much for being here. It's a very good question. As your governor, I'm committed to continue making Georgia number one state for business. But, like I said out there, I'm not sure it's the right thing to do to give Amazon $11 billion when I just heard that Jeff Bezos has increased his wealth to up to $115 billion. Now, I was a small businessman in Austin, Texas. With common sense principles, my sports leagues tripled their revenue. Okay, and as your governor, I, like Brian Kemp said, I'm a small businessman, and we know the history of this great Republican nation and this great state of Georgia. Small businesses drive the economic engine. Okay, we know that. So I don't believe it's my job as governor to pick winners or losers with tax breaks. But of course I'd love to have Amazon come, the 50,000 jobs. But again, back to the money that we're going to give them. So it's like kind of like a double-edged sword, Mr. Governor. We will grow jobs. We will make cut the regulations, provide the necessary spending to help small businessmen like myself and others create the jobs of their dreams, create the businesses of their dreams. And we can do this because we will continue to make Georgia the best state in the nation, not just for business, okay, but I want to double our food production, and that's another issue. But thank you for being here, and next question.
All right, I promised the Chinese community newspaper a question.
Good evening. Even though in 2017, in Georgia, there are still many schools fail. If you become a governor, what would you do to improve the educational system in Georgia?
Well, thank you for the question. It's one of the most fundamental things that we do at the state level. We're having so many burdensome rules and regulations on teachers where teachers can't even teach. We're burdening our principals where principals can't even lead. And so what I want to do is infuse the economic principle of competition into K-12 education and empower families to have more choices and options. And you do that by allowing the money to follow the child. I think that will elevate all boats in K-12 education. And it will also have the net effect, I believe, of reducing the burdensome rules and regulations on our teachers because they'll then have to compete to keep students in their classroom.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Well, I think we need to have innovation, number one, but also local control. We've got to be able to trust our parents with their child's future, put faith in our local educators. I'm certainly supportive of creating competition as well. With schools choice, part of one of our plans, which is on our website, is to allow military children to participate in an educational savings account that gives them flexibility. So there are not, you know, there is not a one-size-fits-all from state government mentality in education. If anything, we need to move away from that and empower our local educators and administrators to teach our children and empower their parents.
All right, thank you, sir.
The very first thing that we need to do to improve education here in Georgia is to eliminate Common Core from our curriculum. Also, we need to make sure that more of the tax dollars that we allocate to education goes to the teachers and to the classrooms. Right now, there is a disproportionate amount that goes into the admin layer of education. So do a better job of strengthening that admin function and send the money down to, again, the classroom and the teachers. Also, the number one most important success factor of the education of a child is the involvement of the parent. We need to make sure that parents feel like they have a say in their child's education. One of the things that I will do as governor is today the state board of education is appointed by the governor. I'd like to see that elected by the people of Georgia so they can have a say in the education of their students or their children.
Thank you, sir.
Our children are literally our future. If you look at the way we can predict how many prison beds we'll need in 10 to 15 years, it's how many third graders can read. And in our state, less than 2/3 of our third graders read at a third grade level. We live in a state where over 40% of our children are born out of wedlock. The classroom, increasingly, is not a place of discipline and focus and learning. It's a place where teachers' creativity is stifled, or they teach to a test when they fear for their safety along with the safety of their children. And that's got to stop. There's so many things that we need to do to move our education system forward. But one of the most important things is when children walk into a classroom, it needs to be a place of focus and discipline. Also, they need to be able to read. Our third grade reading, our early reading, has got to be a whatever it takes bet. Because if that's not in place, that's a math book, that's a science problem, that's a vocational manual. Every other piece of our future is being built on a shaky foundation.
Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you. And I think all the candidates can agree, I am the only teacher up here right now. Okay, I was a master educator, God bless, here at Norcross High School for 6 years, 11 years in the county. And Team Urbach, we believe in local control of education. And as your governor, I will call President Trump, as I've already made calls and emails into the White House, and I will tell President Trump, dear President Trump, I cannot stop Georgia's money going to DC, but as the governor of Georgia, I will not accept any strings attached from DC. And what I'm talking about is United Nations Common Core. I use the phrase top down, okay? Top down is from the United Nations, the Department of Education, down to Georgia. And I'm not gonna accept that. And all the thousands of people that I've talked to for 8 months, thousands of people, they want local control of our schools. Because when Jimmy Carter created the United States Department of Education, it is an illegal agency. The states have a contract with the federal government, it's called the United States Constitution. And the states did not allow the federal government to control our schools, our education. And like Governor Ellis Arnold in 1943, he said, quote, education is the cure of ignorance, poverty, and disease. And as your governor, I fully believe that. Unfortunately, today's modern Common Core is causing ignorance, poverty, and disease. And my friends that are in the universities and high schools and all the contacts I have in Georgia from educators like myself, they know this is a serious problem. So we have to fix our schools, because as your governor, my oath to God, every student in this great state should be receiving the best education and equal opportunities in the classroom. So thank you so much.
Okay, you go ahead and give him back the mic.
Okay, thank you.
And Kanishwa. Last question, as I promised, that a lot of the community newspapers from the various communities here in Gwinnett a lot of times don't get access to candidates for governor. So I would like the last question to come from the Chinese community newspaper, and that's going to wrap it up. Okay?
Thank you so much. I'm with Atlanta Chinese Life. Everybody knows America and China are really try to grow the relationship between this international trade. I know in the past few years, we have a lot of, you know, made in China manufacturer coming here. But I want to know, if you are elected as a government, how can you do anything to sell Georgia to China or anything into international trade?
Well, Georgia has outstanding products and services, and we want to do business with anybody that's going to be legal and ethical in their dealings with us. You know, one of the things I supported President Trump with was how he called China out as a nation, not the people that are here, but as a nation, the way that they manipulated currencies and things of that sort. But in terms of trying to bring Chinese or Taiwanese people here, or Japanese, it doesn't matter where they come from. That's what makes America great. We want to have a free market where people that can come here can reach their full potential and their dreams, so long as they come here legally. And that's what we want to focus on here in Georgia. We also want to open up our markets from a farming standpoint, agricultural, so that we have more markets around the country that want to take in our exports. That's very important as well.
Well, just a little bit on more on the ag side of things. I mean, we have tremendous opportunities in the state of Georgia. We're already sending a lot of our agricultural products to China when you think about cotton, pecans, peanuts, and other things. Part of our plan to strengthen rural Georgia talks about increasing and taking the Georgia Grown program internationally, so we continue to expand the footprint of business in Georgia with other countries. That obviously would include China. But also, I'm a firm believer that trade is a two-way street. So we've got to continue to be a state where we literally not only
recruit in the United States, but all over the world, for business to continue to give Georgians great opportunities, and I'll certainly be a governor that does that.
Yeah, as governor, I would love to do business with China. Y'all have one of the fastest growing economies in the world, and we need to be business partners. And a big part of what Georgia needs to do is to create a regulatory environment in which all business thrives. We need to eliminate our state income tax and make it easy for the Chinese that want to come into the state of Georgia to do business, that it's really easy for them to get their business license, to get their operations up and running. Also in Georgia, we don't tax the electricity on manufacturing. I think that's a huge plus for Chinese manufacturing companies that might want to come to Georgia. Also, the workforce development that we have. We have Georgia Tech, University of Georgia, a lot of higher education facilities that will help to staff the businesses that the Chinese will want to bring into our state, as well as we need to make sure that we get the funds from D.C. to deepen the port of Savannah so that we'll have the ability to ship the large cargo containers to and from Georgia and China.
In my background, I've never run for office before, but I've been a successful global technology business executive. I was a Navy SEAL. So between war and global business, I've operated on most of the continents on the planet. So global business experience, selling assets and people, and the great skills that we have here abroad, this is actually what I've done throughout my career. And I would, I think, be very, very well suited to do that wherever that main business may be, including China. Now, one of the things that makes us great is our inherent innovation as a people. And we've got to ensure that we've got great protection around our intellectual property. We've got to make sure we're competing on a level playing field. And those are some of the things that I think are unbelievably important as we seek to do business with companies abroad and industries abroad with regards to Georgia. Thank you.
Okay, well, I've talked as a former small businessman in the past 8 months. I talked to a lot of business owners, and God bless the great state of Georgia, because there's all so many different types of people here, different types of immigrants from China, Japan, all sorts of countries. And I think how you say hello in Chinese is it Kenpao?
Ni hao.
I'm sorry, ni hao, ni hao. So as your governor here in Georgia, we will continue to have a very, very good an excellent trade relationship with the great country of China. What I'd like to see from the people of China is for them to start talking about how they should be treated more properly. I know from business matters the past 20 years that some Chinese employees are not paid what they should get paid, okay? And I'm running for governor for the people of Georgia, not for me. I'm trying to improve their lives. And as we continue great trade with the great nation of China, I want to improve the lives of Chinese, the people of China, okay? And we're doing so many wonderful things together as we export our goods and they export their goods, working together in peace. Because we know when nations trade and interact with each other with products and dialogue, there's peace and happiness and security. And as the governor of Georgia, to the people of China, God bless you and your families, and we will develop and continue to make both countries great, and we will always be have a strong alliance between these two great nations. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I'm sorry that we only have time for certain questions, but they have to get out and start talking to the voters. You are all welcome to go out into the lobby, and if you want to catch them individually, please do so.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
How are you?
Glad you came.
What's your name? Hey, Tom. God bless you. Nice to meet you. All right. God bless you. Excuse me? Well, God like you, because I'm not running for me. I'm running for every Georgian, our posterity, our future children. Yes, sir.